I'm told reliably that something is about to happen. I don't know what, but it's about to happen. I think it concerns Mr. Ron Tudor. Okay, 5, 4, 3.
Tiny little unit.
No!
Jesus, he's aged!
Oh, wait.
I don't know who I am!
We know that, Wally. Take it easy.
Lucky Ron.
Hey! Woo!
Mr. Ron Tudor, welcome. Nice to have you eventually. Thanks for coming. In the boardroom getting pissed while we're all here waiting for you. Dynamic television, I can assure you. I was at a roast about 6 months ago in Sydney for one Molly Meldrum. And it was a variety club roast, and it was disgraceful. It was the biggest disaster we've ever been through. I mean, they got up there, one after another, Jonathan Coleman, all those guys who can't wait to get on television, have no talent. They got up there, and they said nice things about him. And they sat there and said wonderful things. They even said he was heterosexual. They went on and on about how wonderful Molly was and the women he'd been out with. Tonight is not going to be that sort of night. I know that because I've seen some of the material that's been prepared for this evening. I sat home yesterday afternoon and watched some things on video, and I decided, you can all get nicked, I'm not coming. I don't want to be part of this tawdry, tacky, disgraceful moment for Ron Tudor. None of them believe you're 60 years of age, and I don't either. You don't look your age, certainly. You look much older than that. You are, as some people might say, probably one of the largest shareholders in telecom I've ever met. Before I even knew you, before I even knew who the hell you were. I mean, you look like an old Harry Messel with a strange beard. I keep getting these telegrams from you. When I worked for the bubblegum station at 3XY, these telegrams would come in from this Ron Tudor, muscling his way in saying, do this, say that, don't do this. I wouldn't do this, or say that, or do that. And he sent me another telegram. I mean, he's an inveterate telegram sender, as you're all well aware. I am entitled to be nasty to this man tonight. Not that I know him even half as much as many of you, but because I tried earlier this year to have this great 40th birthday. That's a third younger than you are. A third, a whole third. And I thought it had gone off very well, and I'm on radio a couple of days later, and somebody called me up and said, oh, Darren, did you read The Sun on Valentine's Day? And I said, well, I read the front 20 pages. You colour it in for the rest. You colour it in for the first 20, usually.
Don't do that.
And I said, no, I haven't. And they said, oh, you should read this. And I've now dug out what was in the sun. So I'm allowed to say anything about you tonight that I like, because I was defiled in your excuse or your honour or your name, whatever you like to call it, some awful, disgusting fight you have with some woman in your life. In print.
Thank you.
Murray Tregoning lives. And it says in the biggest selling newspaper in Australia, and this woman read it out to me, and for a moment, foolishly, I tried to protect you. I pretend I didn't know who it was they were talking about. And it said, to the number one mongrel. This is St. Valentine's Day, right? All this stuff like, you know, roses are... I mean, this is a day when people write things like, roses are red, violets are blue, I'm schizophrenic and so am I. All that sort of stuff. And this thing said, to the number one mongrel, patron of Australia's glorious talent. Bullshit to start with. I mean, look what he did for, you know, for Karen Knowles. Took her career, he turned it around, it was rising, he took her on and... It says, thank you for the gown and for taking me to Darren's party. Signed, Bruce Mansfield. No. you have redeemed all. I am forgetting about your wife, your daughter, easy forgettable, we often go to the Hilton together, Madagascar, which you have to explain later, the south of France, the fur, the interest-free loan, living together, and the other women in your life. It's not me, this is not even a roast. This is in the Melbourne Sun newspaper. 640,000 copies went out that day, and everybody knew who they were talking about because I told them on air. I am framing the check. Well, you always had to buy it. You'll remain a fable in your own mind and a foible in mine. Dear little fossil. I like that bit. Dear little fossil. I just said tired old tart, but dear little fossil will do. Dear little fossil, I just love you because whenever there's a drought, you never forget your Macintosh. Isn't that lovely? The lady in question, she paid to take him to my birthday party. That's beside the point. Anyway, that's all I'm going to say tonight. I can't... Well, one more thing. I can't believe, actually, Mr. Tudor, that we actually came here tonight. Friday night, as you know in the business, is a night to go out, spend your time with friends, get drunk, or go home, or forget where you went, or any of those things. And we all came here to your roast. They invited you. You turned up at 10 to 8. 20 minutes late, they told me I had to be at 2:30 this afternoon for rehearsal. Now, I know it takes you like Molly Meldrum 60 hours of tape like you did with Cheetah to get one record down. This is bullshit. So when your daughter Megan said, can you please come at 1:45? I said, get fucked, I'd go out on Fridays. So she said, all right, I'll compromise. Can you come at 5:45? I'd have still been 2.25 hours early. And Randall McDonald was here at 3:00 PM saying, good old Collingwood forever. I'll tell you a story about him, about a guy who was too intelligent. He worked with John Blackman and and Bruce Mansfield on the morning show, and he found that he couldn't relate to them because he was so intelligent. And he went to his doctor, went to Richard Ward, a football doctor, and he said, look, can you just do one thing for me? Can you please just... lower my IQ a little bit. I don't want to get real fuckwit. I mean, I don't want to be like a listener for 3KZ or 3XY. I just want to be lowered slightly so I can actually relate to my friends, so I can talk to Glenn Wheatley, you know, down that level. And the doctor said, well, I suppose I can do that for you. Yeah, a little bit. He said, we have this psychic electronic mumbo jumbo. We can do this for you. I'll put it on this machine for... It's not a lobotomy, but it's like that. You've had one. It'll take about 3 minutes, and you'll be down to their level. So they did it. In the middle of the machine being turned on, put the thing on his head. He went outside, and he had an argument with his girlfriend, the doctor. Dr. Death. And he was there, and he came back after 25 minutes. And he thought, my God, I've forgotten this poor bastard who's out there with his machine on. And he turned the switch off, and he thought he died. And the guy woke up. And he said, are you okay? How are you? Are you okay? And the guy said, good old Collingwood. Good old forever. They know how to play the game. Murray is out there somewhere. Anyway, enough of me. That's all I'm going to say tonight. There are some friends who are not prepared to present their stories tonight, and I don't blame them. They were the smart ones who said, well, video, yeah, we'll do it on Thursday, we'll do it on Friday, we'll do it on Monday. The other ones who can get away with it, they're here on the comfort, I should say, on the comfort and the security, we'll use it in court, on the comfort and security of videotape. Just watch Bruce Mansfield's late in the evening. Watch the man sweating like a pig while Johnny Young says terrible things about 13-year-old girls. I'm not a child any longer. Can I break away? Can I steal a day to make me stronger?
Well, Ron, it's really an honour for me today to be asked to come along and say a few words concerning your 60th birthday, and I suppose it's really a time to think back on some of the early days when I first knew you, and of course you were at W&G at that time when I was the office boy at KZ, and even then I could see the tremendous impact you were going to have on music, like just recalling some of those household names that you introduced in those days, people like Georgie Bracken and Frankie Davidson and his great hit Muldoon the Glutton. I mean, songs that have just lasted right throughout the ages. You know, Joanne Campbell's Cookie Little Paradise, just all these enormous songs. And then, of course, when they had that scandal about you being caught at the gay bar at the Australia Hotel and having it shut down from your own record company at Fable, you just continued the trend, you know, with people like Dave Costello, I mean, Peter McKenna. Just names that just everybody just still swoons over. Groups like, you know, the Fourth House. I could just go on and on. So these enormous successes that you've had, I know, are going to continue. And I guess I might let the cat out of the bag by just mentioning that you're going to start a new label called Miracle Records. And the catch cry is going to be, if it's a hit, and it's a miracle. So thanks again, mate, for some exciting times, and have a great 60th birthday.
It'd be hard to talk about Ron Tudor without telling a mongrel story. I thought about the hand up the dress at Wally Pike's party. I thought about Stephen Foster's girlfriend at his album launch. And I thought about the day he got Carol Savage on the floor at the Palmerston Hotel. What came out of that day, after Ron was thrown out of the hotel, I found him in the laneway behind the Palmerston Hotel ripping Philip Webster's shirt off, in the process of thumping him against the wall saying, I fucking love you. If there's one thing Ron Tudor taught me, it's that expression, and Ron, we fucking love you.
See, there's one story that I didn't think I'd have the nerve to tell, but apparently it's going to be fairly safe, and that's the story of the red toothbrush. And at various points of time, Ron might have some ladies visiting him, and you say, hey, don't worry, I bought you your own toothbrush, and it's a red one, and they're all using the same one.
Another story I recall about Ron was when he was having traumas with one of his ladies, and she happened to be living in the same block of units, so she rang him and said, if you don't patch it up with me, I'm going to commit suicide. I'm going to put my head in the oven. Ron said, go ahead, you silly mole, it's electric.
Matthew Finder just come to work with us from New York, and those of you will probably remember Matthew's father, Bob, was our first chief executive at AAV. I'd warned him about this group of people called the Mongrels, of which Tudor was the leader. Anyhow, he got to know the Mongrel fairly quickly, and eventually Matthew had a party at his new flat, his apartment, and invited a few people along, including Ted and Jay Gregory and Alan Bremner and his wife Kath and a few other people. Tudor obviously was pretty primed that night, because not long into the evening he decided that the place needed a bit of livening up. So next thing we see him reaching over and taking Brendan Wright's shoe off. As if that wasn't enough, he starts pouring champagne into his shoe and drinking from it. Not content with that, he decided he had to have Brendan's sock. So he fills his sock up with champagne and squeezes it out and starts drinking it. Well, I don't know, I think at about that time, I think three women fainted, another four people screamed, a couple of people left off the balcony. I think Matthew cancelled his visa. You're a mongrel, Ron.
We thought we'd put the easy ones on early. They are the compliments, and we thought we'd put the shit on later in the evening, so that's okay. You, Ron, okay? I now want to introduce you to the panel. I should say the first stuff you saw there was Ron's 50th birthday. He's gone downhill since then. That was his birthday present, and she turned him down. On the first panel of roasters of the roastee, Mr. Tudor, are Paul Jennings. Paul Jennings, of course, well known to all of you. His career went into a great decline when Malcolm Fraser got done in the last election. It's sort of a used to panel. We had we have Brian Cadd, who used to make records, and we have we also have Jeff Cox. Jeff Cox used to sell cars, and also used to throw petrol on barbecues. Anyway, this is the panel, gentlemen. It's all yours.
Well, thanks very much indeed, Darren. Paul Jennings will step aside now because the Prime Minister can't wait.
And I'd like to say to you, Ron, in respect of the bloody questions which haven't been put yet, but I'm sick and tired of bloody immigration being discussed around the bloody place. I'd rather discuss issues like euthanasia, but I felt... euthanasia, I think they're no worse here than over there, but... I've been listening to what Darren's been saying, Darren, and tonight we have been hearing mainly the bad things about you, Ted, but I propose tonight to talk about the good things. Well, there goes nothing. But... Ted, of course, is a man that's been very successful, in getting 75% of the ratings, and you've been very successful in many ways, not only in the record industry, but from what I hear, getting little girls into bed, but not before telling them a bedtime story. But I would like just to finish off my bit before the other particular roasters in this particular segment take over, and just to tell you that not many people in the audience know this, but... Ron is to take on a very important overseas posting. It's been made by Peter Feynman. That is the executive director of the new Beirut Visitors and Convention Centre. I'll bow out now, and I believe, Nifty, you want to say a few words, Nif?
As long as it's not going to be in the ABC. Our Ron, very mercenary type, always doing things on the cheap. Why, instead of putting stereo in his car, he just changes radio stations to whatever it's on the car next to him. And come and see me, Ron. I don't take up too much of your time because I know that my old mate, Johnny Howard, he's a mate of mine, Johnny Howard.
Well, I suppose, as I said, many times before, when it comes to comedy, why do they bloody well put me in? But our guest of honour, I believe, is a man who really knows where he's at, and unfortunately at his age he forgot why it's there. But I understand that Tudor attained his success because he really knows how to sell, and he's a great salesman. No question about that. Why, when he was living in Rome, he worked for Franco Cotto. He had a department store over there in Rome and sold the paper double bed.
Aspetta, Franco Cotto, dovete andare a North Melbourne, foot is grey.
And of course, there's me, Sir Billy McMahon. And you know, I have been, Ron, a man that's put great emphasis on physical fitness. Every morning I run up and down on the spot. I do press up. And when I get out of bed... I won't go into that, but Ron, you're a very real hepped-up guy. You're so hyperactive, you can even sit down standing up. And I know there's someone else here. I don't know this man, but he full forward for Geelong. What's your name, sir?
Well, that's Jacko. Not too many people know this, but, Tudor one time, he had a tragic accident. Nobody knows that he had a tragic accident. He ended up his reproductive organ reattached, and I think they called it microsurgery.
And of course there's me, Sir Billy Snedden. Order. Orders. Orders, please, at Joyo's restaurant tomorrow for lunch. But really, Tude, we are honouring you tonight. Our guest of honour, he has a scrapbook. A wonderful scrapbook featuring the highlights of his life. And one of these days, there'll be a page two.
And of course, it's me, Tommy Lyle. And you know, Tommy, you sure can't even forget his name, what you? Ron Tudor, you reckon one of the great qualities of our man of the hour is his modesty. It's his modesty. Why, he's so modest. He even has his gold American Express card repainted green.
And this is Harry Beitzel, and you know, Ron, tonight, I'm here to tell you that Ron Tudor, he's got a great athletic prowess. He really is a great, so athletic as our Ron. Yes, he once joined a health club and then dropped out because the members were all lousy card players.
And of course, this is Bert Newton, you know, Ron, I'll be on a little later on in a video, but not many people know this, but Ron Tudor is a very private person. He really is. You know, he's so private, he recently threw out his personal computer and it was getting too personal, so Ron, to you, and from Patty, and the kids, thank you very much indeed, and thank you very much, everybody, and don't forget my show on Monday night, and Darren, you'll be there, won't you? Thank you very much indeed.
Ladies and gentlemen, Paul Jennings, fantastic, Paul. Thank you, mate. And next, the man who used all those voices trying to sell cars, Jeff Cox.
It's very difficult to follow that, but of course, Ron, Brian and I have spent many years with you over the last 20 years. You told me once that you were going to make us both stars, and especially with myself, you told me that we would be very famous, and I know the first record I ever played on was for you, and that was Marshall's portable music machine, and I still haven't been fucking paid for that. And it was on a Sunday, which is double time, I'd like to add that. But any resemblance to the Ron Tudor sitting here, the humanitarian, the feeling, loving man, and the resemblance that Brian and I relate tonight is purely coincidental. Ron Tudor, MBE, OD, half bar, full bar, whatever you like, half bar is probably closer. The man is a genius. I remember when he came in one day and he said he'd had to go and meet the chairman of the ABC. Not the chairman of Victoria, but in fact the chairman of Australia. And we all went. And as this gentleman walked over in his inimitable style, pulled himself to his full height and said, "Doc Madden." Ron looked at him and said, "Hi, Doc, Ron Tudor." I mean, this is the man. This is the man we're talking about tonight. This is, and I'm sorry also that before we go on, before Brian tells his story, that anything in this room, please don't let it go out, because we could get
I
into
can't go
very,
along with that.
Very serious, very serious trouble. So, Mr. Cadd.
Thank you so much. What about that? Isn't that fantastic? What a great story.
great beginning. Personally, I think that any of these stories that concern young women and all of those filthy top bits and bottom bits. In my personal experience, this man and I, separately or together, have never indulged in any of those areas. And in all of the years that we've known each other, which has been some 10 or 11 or, depends on the contractor, 10 or 11 years, and during that time, we've never indulged in any of those things. But I might tell you a story which I think illustrates the humanitarianism of this man. And you, anyone out there who knows him will know that he's a very human guy, a warm, friendly, caring person who loves to help people in trouble, particularly women in trouble. And let me relate this little story, which happened at the 1973 Radio Awards, which several of you out there will remember. At the Siebel Townhouse. How am I doing, huh? Wait till we get to the American stories. And this illustrates my friend and tutor, Ron, who spent the entire first day only living on beer. I mean, against his wishes, I might tell you. They were out there running him ragged. He was there doing it. Wasn't he? He was doing it. He shared a room with a very conservative, older member of the recording industry. And of course, that's great because that's the same. They didn't indulge in drinking, in any of those in and out bits. None of those bits, they... None of those. Are you here tonight, sir, are you? No. You're much older than that, aren't you? And Tudor, after 36 hours on Foster's, decided to go upstairs to his bedroom for an early night. He negotiated his way up the stairs to his floor, turned, walked along the corridor, and standing almost in front of his room was this very forlorn, dare I say, desperate, anguished,
you remember,
young woman with a statuesque body in front of his room. And he ran up to her. He said, my love, I'm a humanitarian. You don't know me, but I'm a humanitarian. And these are my cards. And whatever it is, it's not as bad as you think. And she said, well, it's pretty bad because he's left me in. And I think the balcony is the only, off the balcony is my only thing. And he said, well, come into my room because my roommate, who is a lot older than me, is downstairs throwing up with Dick Hemming, and he won't be here for hours yet. Thank you. You've been waiting 10 minutes, haven't you? So, despite his pleading, she got him into the room, and they were in there, and she said one of the things that... My whole thing is that I'm totally devastated with this man, and I have to throw myself off a balcony. And it so happened that he had a balcony. This is a true story. Had a balcony. She heads for the balcony. Ron, being the humanitarian he is, leaps on her, rips her off the balcony, back into the room, throws her onto the bed, covers her with his body. All right? This is a very humanitarian to do. Think of it. She says, can I tell you the story? She tells him the story. She gets worked up. She's back on the balcony, balancing. He's thrown himself down, back on the bed. He's covering her with his body. This thing goes on for a half an hour. Finally, he gets her into the bed, covers her up, and just as he's lying back thinking, what a great thing I've done, his sharing mate opens the door. Well, so enough to say that the next day, the rumors were rampant. I'm not going to tell you what was said, but that night at the Radio Awards in 1973, he won Independent, Humanitarian, and Body Covering Award for 1973. Ron Tudor.
One of the interesting things when we went to America was the tutor got us on the plane, and he said, you bastards, he said, you walk down the street, everybody knows, he said, we're on even terms. We get to the States, the chicks, whatever, We're all even. Right, Ron? You said that. You remember saying that? Good, fine. I remember him getting off the plane at Los Angeles Airport and two big black blokes ran over him and said, Abe, you're going to free us this time. So anyway, laugh it up. We're drinking, we're having a quiet one off the foyer of the... on Highland, what was that called?
The Holiday Inn.
The Holiday Inn off Highland.
It was the happy hour.
It was the happy hour, right? This guy used to go down at 2:30 in the afternoon and wait for the happy hour, but that's another story. This chick, I swear, this chick came in, black, about this tall, lovely lady. She had a shower cap on her head, which is rather strange.
We're going to tell this now.
She came over and consequently found out we're all in a band and we're going to be famous. So she sat down and she said, champagne, champagne. So Ron did the right thing, bought her champagne. She said, oh, this cheap ship, French. Well, we didn't know she was French. He bought her some French champagne. Didn't he? So anyway, this all happens, you see, and Tudor has to excuse himself because the maitre d' from the restaurant on top of the Holiday Inn had come in and said, somebody's let the lobsters out of the tank and it's your fault. So Tudor said, I'll fix this up. So off he's gone, we're having a drink with this lass. And as I sit here, 140 Australian tourists arrived in the foyer of the Holiday Inn at this stage. They were all, or most, from Melbourne. At this stage, Ron had gone upstairs, got the lobster, put it back in the tank, which we had nothing to do with, I may add, and had gone, of course, because his hands are a bit, how's your father, had gone to wash his hands. At that time, he turned the tap on. The tap, in fact... Sorry, I'll go a little slow for you. He turned the tap on. Of course, the water splashed from the basin completely over a pair of light grey trousers. Like this. A huge stain. At this stage, he's decided to come back and talk to the black lady, being a humanitarian as he is, and find out what her story was. He has walked out of the lift. He has come around the corner, at which stage 140 people, all from Melbourne, have in fact recognised him. The black lady has come out of the bar and in front of these people looks, stared him straight in the face and said, Ronnie, you've urinated all over the front of your trousers. Absolutely true. Dare I tell a lie?
I should point out... three things from that discussion from the gentleman on my left. One is that Dick Hamer was not staying at the Holiday Inn at the time. Brian mentioned Dick Hemmings, and Dick's collection of Nazi memorabilia will be raffled at the dinner after this function. And Jeffrey was talking about Ron's MBE, which you may think means one thing, but to most people in this room means you mongrel bastard personified, or exemplified, I should say, to make it rhyme. Now, he said many skeletons in his closet. You had a few of them just sort of dribbled out at the moment. There are going to be more. Many more will come out tonight. And if he's got any sense, he'll go home early. One such case, Mr. Tudor, is that of a secret torch that Ron, a fable you might say, he's been carrying for a lady he's spoken to only once on the telephone. Shut up, nothing to do with you. You can get him on the Mike Wall show, you can't stop this one. Here she is now with a special message for Ron Tudor.
I must say, I'm sorry, dear Ron, I cannot sing you a song. But all on my own, I made up this poem just to help your birthday along. As best as I'm able, it won't be a fable, but I'll try not to make it too long. So let's keep it short and all take a port just to help your birthday along. But as you must perceive, I just cannot believe that such a young fellow is 50. And you must believe I'm not trying to deceive, just to help your birthday along.
I would like to wish you, on behalf of all the artists involved in the Australian recording industry, a happy 60th birthday. So, happy 60th, Ron Tudor.
Tudor. Who's Ron Tudor?
Well, hi there.
Hello there.
It gives us great pleasure. It
certainly does.
Yeah. To be amongst you and around you this evening, specifically for our old mate Ron, who is 600 today, someone told me.
Dear old Ron. Ron, I'm doing this with one of my old heads because yours is. Yeah. Is that all right?
Yeah, and the rest of you.
Yes.
What a great supporter of Hey Hey It's Saturday and Hey Hey It's Saturday Night Ron has been over the years.
Just
getting serious for a moment.
Yeah, there's nothing that Ron wouldn't do for us.
And there's nothing that we wouldn't do for Ron. And that's how we go through life together, doing absolutely nothing for each other. Ron actually has been responsible for a telecoms profit. I've never known a man to send that many telegrams. That's just one of his old ones.
One telegram.
No, it is.
That many telegrams? One telegram.
Yes, all right. But over the years...
And it's collect.
It always is. We'd like to speak to you about that, Ron. We hate paying for your telegrams. Thank you, and we hope you're having a wonderful night there. Fond memories I have of coming back with you from Ballarat and keeping you up all night.
And getting back.
Well, it wasn't me who kept you up. It was Marg Annesley, the makeup lady at Channel
9. Doesn't take much to get him up, does it?
Never had a feel in that direction, but I'm sure that Ron's a very happy man because this is a complete surprise to him. He's only known for a couple of weeks, and there are lots of people here who'd like to, to wish you all the best.
There's something I've always wanted to tell Ron, too, that your razor's not working, Ron.
It really isn't.
I think you should get a new blade for us.
Of course, Ron, you've been a man who we've known and loved, we've known for many years.
You're speaking as if he's dead.
Here's another man.
Hi, Ron. I couldn't be with you tonight. Happy 60th birthday. And you're all probably wondering why Ron's wearing black underwear. We understand there's just been a death in his pants.
Just cutting through the laughter now. We would like to...
happy birthday.
Yes.
That's a Queensland greeting.
That was your first wife, Ron. No, it wasn't. Jackie McDonald. We wish you a very happy 60th from all of the crew. Say happy birthday.
Okay.
That was recorded, Ron. We're not that sincere.
No.
We have Wilbur and the boys over there to play happy birthday for you, and we'll all join in. We'll all the crew just wander in here.
Yes.
Come on, there's got to be someone left in the studio.
Put some feeling in this now.
From all the Hey it's Saturday.
I really think it's amazing, you know. I mean, we put this man down and we laugh at him sometimes, and he's pathetic at sometimes. And he sends telegrams all the time. But he's done more for dental health in this town than anybody in Victoria. I think that's a wonderful thing. Coming up next on the program, the new panel, you've got the man, the age did not weary him, but the years at Collingwood condemned, Ranald McDonald. We also have the Ben Kingsley lookalike and Gandhi stuntman, Mr. Alan Finney. We also have the Channel 7 Kazali automaton, Mr. Mike Brady.
Automaton. It seems an appropriateness about someone who's been in the media to pay tribute to Sir Ronald, because we all know that he never likes to be quoted, he never likes publicity, and therefore I think it's important to recognise that aspect, his modesty. His unwillingness to be a recipient of any publicity. And therefore, that's why I feel so happy to be here this evening to pay tribute to him. There's a second reason, and that is that we were making an application for a license for Fox, what became Fox FM. We had the dead weight, could be one term used, of Wilf Barker. But anyway, somehow in our consortium, we had to counterbalance Wilf Barker. I don't know whether that's a turkey or Muriel. Anyway, so we looked for someone with integrity, with modesty, with sex appeal, with the sort of image, anyway, that to persuade the Broadcasting Tribunal that Fox, that the consortium that were the eventual winners for Fox, should get it. We tried Bob Hawke, that was no good. Bert Newton wasn't available that day. And finally we ended up with Ron Tudor. He came with Dennis Gibbons' immodest help with the concept of contemporary classical, a tape which bears no relation to the programming of Fox, but persuaded the tribunal that this was the sound needed for the FM airwaves. And he played the tape. He looked intelligent. He looked the sort of man you'd like to have as a director of a new FM radio, certainly someone competing with Bill Armstrong. And so we got the license. I feel it's very important for history, for the history of pop music, for the history of radio, for the history of media, should be recognized Ron's contribution with contemporary classical, a term that no one, as far as I know, knows what it means, bears no relation to what Fox has produced ever since, and certainly Rhett Walker, of course, recognized very quickly that contemporary classical was not the way to move up in the ratings, and has been discarded and never referred to since. So, Ron, thank you for all you did for Fox. You got us the license, and you haven't inhibited us since.
Mr. Ronald McDonald, he won't be laughing tomorrow when Collingwood loses. Mr. Alan Finney.
Ladies and gentlemen, Ron's been such a great part of the entertainment scene and in his business sense as well, that I thought it might be appropriate, given my personal interest, to talk about Ron in terms of the great screen characters, because what none of us have realised is that through the great Hollywood movies, a lot of authors have put words into characters' mouths that adequately and so precisely describe our honoured guest tonight. Let me give you some topics. Ron and his modesty and sex life, a joint subject. As Woody Allen said in Annie Hall, quote, "Hey, don't knock masturbation, it's sex with someone I love." Ron, and this very rich and deep subject of the love that the fellow men, that all of us have for Ron. As Gene Kelly said to Frederick March in Inherit the Wind, quote, "He hasn't an enemy in the world, only his friends hate him." Ron, and here is a topic we could discuss for seconds, Ron and his good looks. As Lee Remick said to Jack Lemmon in The Days of Wine and Roses, quote, "Thanks for the compliment, but I know how I look. This is the way I look when I'm sober. It's enough to make a person drink, wouldn't you say?" Ron and his a subject dear to his heart and the heart and in fact the bristles of all toothbrushes in this crowd tonight, Ron and his development of new talent. As Maggie Smith said in The Prime of Miss Jean Brodie, quote, "Little gals, I'm in the business of putting old heads on young shoulders, and all my pupils are the creme de la creme. Give me a girl of an impressionable age, and she is mine for life." But finally, there's been enough frivolity. A sincere toast to Mr. Ron Tudor. As Howard St. John, who I know is known and revered by us all, said to Broderick Crawford in Born Yesterday, quote, "To all the dumb chumps and all the crazy broads, past, present and future, who thirst for knowledge and search for truth, who fight for justice and civilize each other and make it so tough for crooks like you and me." Thank you very much.
Alan Finney. Mr. Brady.
Well, I was going to read a lengthy speech that I had prepared at great expense, Ron, but I couldn't afford to pay the bill because you haven't settled the last royalty statement for Kazaley. I'm sure it's coming. So I'd like to, it went on for ages and ages about money, you know, and all that sort of stuff, so we won't go into that. Suffice to say that we all know you're a lovely rogue, right? I'd like to talk about women, Ron, and women. Woody Allen, if I can mention Woody Allen again, Alan, has a saying, "If it moves, fondle it." Ron dribbles on it, spills beer on it, and trips over it. Any attractive woman that moves him or moves into his immediate vicinity moves him to clumsy incoherence. He becomes a danger to himself and to anyone nearby. He's got a turbocharged sex drive, but no steering or brakes. That was worth the money. If Ron's in a room and a woman walks in, he should be registered as unroadworthy, I reckon. If you can excuse me for 10 seconds, I'd like to grab Terry Dean's guitar and just sing a little ode to you, Ron. One sec.
He writes the lyrics on the guitar. I've seen him do this before. With up there, Kazali.
Oh, they're down here, Darren. They're down here. You ready? Don't be nervous, Ron.
Well, he works to earn a living. Hang on. He talks to earn a living. At a million miles an hour, he could sell a fridge to Eskimos. He could get the libs back in power. Ron, he likes wheeling and dealing round the town. In a business full of assholes, Sir Ronnie wins hands down. Up there, Sir Ronnie, in there and fight. Out there and at 'em, show 'em your might. Up there, Sir Ronnie, don't let 'em in. Fight like the devil, you're out there to win.
The deep bit, Ron.
Now there's a lot more things to Tudor than really meets the eye. He's a man of great integrity. He taught me how to lie. You either love or hate him. There's nothing in between. When Tudor says, "You're kidding," what the hell does he mean?
What does he mean?
2, 3, 4. Up there, Sir Ronnie. In there. Fight out there and at 'em, show 'em your might. Up there, Sir Ronnie, show 'em your heart. Fight like the devil, the crowd's on your side. Up there, Sir Ronnie, 60 years not out. Get out there and give 'em hell. That's what he's all about. That's what he's all about. That's what.
Michael Brady. I was told this afternoon, I said, so I'm going to have to do this thing for bloody Ron Tudor tonight, and I've got to go to this roast, and then it's going to take a while Friday night, and I can't go to the farm, I just had a calf up there, and I can't go and do this. And I said, what do I say about him? And somebody said, well, talk about his sex life. I said, I don't know about his sex life. I've heard rumours, I don't know about it. And I said, well, just say, this is a John Blackman gag, it's very bad taste. I shan't dance on top of my underwear or appear on national television in that fashion. But they said, well, just say about Ron Tudor that he'll fuck anything that moves, and if it doesn't, he'll fuck it till it does. Now, I've been told, I've heard some lines. I've heard
boo, hiss, yes.
That was from a man called Steve Turpo, who did that, and not me. I've heard some comments from these three gentlemen here. One, like, they mentioned the Don Lane show, and things done with Don Lane. In fact, that I remember the Don Lane shows, and you were involved with Don. They were very close friends. In fact, that one day, Ron Tudor, last Christmas, just after Don had resigned from Channel 9, and gone off to America to get married, didn't have a baby in this country. And Don went overseas, and this man is so compassionate and so wonderful. He knows people so well. Doesn't send them booze and telegrams. He sent Don Lane the most wonderful Christmas present. He sent him a coffee table, all of Australian mulga wood, beautiful coffee table, and left the glass out. It was a fantastic present that he sent there for that. Alan Finney mentioned the Prime Minister Jean Brodie and referred to the creme de la creme. Showing a bit of culture, Alan. You know, he's embarrassed me on 3 with me, so he showed a bit of culture here with his friends. In fact, you've got the creme de la creme with Zoe Corwell, you got, which is the cream of the cream. You've got the cream of the crap with Ron Tudor over here on my right. Now, Ron has been, as I say, a familiar face on television. Jesus, for years. 60 years of age. Fuck me. Anyway, we'll now take it back to a time when I was mercifully out of the country in 1972. Back to a time... You know how journalists do this thing? They do a day in the life of a star. In the trade, I don't know if you know it, they call it the day in the life of a fool. They did it with him. They call it, this one was a day in the life of Brian Cadd.
And the idea of this thing is
a test for a family concert live album. And is it going to work?
Yeah, we'll do two numbers first.
Who are you going to use first?
We'll use Mississippi first, and then we'll do two numbers with the other band, with a big band.
And how,
hopefully we'll do a finale with all of us.
And how many things are you going to do as a solo?
Three.
What's the final pack for the family group? For everyone in?
Well, it'll either be Honky Tonk Women or Ginger Man, right?
You're 16, you're king!
And we just say a very Merry Christmas to two people who've been with us throughout the year doing a wonderful job as our judges, the beautiful Miss Evie Hayes and Ronnie Tudor. So would you like to sing it with me now? Why not? And you here, sing along as well.
Jingle bells, jingle bells. Dashing through the snow, in a one-horse open sleigh. O'er the fields we go, in a one-horse open sleigh. Dashing through the snow, in a one-horse open sleigh. I say, o'er the fields we go, laughing all the way.
But she asked me to pass on a very special message to you, and she just wanted to say, kick it, Ron, kick it. And the young talent team and Bruce and I just wanted to wish you lots of wonderful, of everything for your 60th birthday. Isn't that true, Bruce?
I don't know whether you know Ron as well as I do, John, but he is a mongrel. And that's not meant to be derogatory to what's his name again?
Ron.
But it's a term of endearment. For you, Ron, good luck and happy birthday.
Thank you. And Ron, we want to say how much we miss you here at Young Talent Time, because you were such a crutch on our program here. And we really wish you lots of luck for the future. And as they say, the classics is a real ball player, isn't he? That's what
I wouldn't have gone as far as that. We had a live audience, so you know the risk that Johnny is taking in saying that, Ron. But
happy birthday, kids.
Happy birthday. Happy birthday.
Wish him a happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you, happy birthday dear Ronnie, happy birthday to you.
We love you, Ronnie.
You're 16,
Ronnie, you're still awesome.
Hello, everybody. Now, I've heard it said that Ron Tudor is to the record industry what Uncle Roy is to radio. But let's face it, Ron Tudor single-handedly made W&G what it is today, an empty parking lot next to the Gill. Well, my association with Ron goes back a pretty long way. And let's face it, Ron is so old, he can remember when hot pants was a condition. Ron still thinks oral sex is talking about it. Anyway, during those early years, was Ron a terrific lover. You've only got to ask Jean what those early years were like. It's just a shame that today we're going through the sexual revolution just when Ron's running out of ammunition. Ron, you really are the Mel Gibson of the menopause set. I know many of your friends and associates are with you tonight. I just want to say, Ron, I reckon you'll remember back in the late 50s, I'm sure you will, a young fellow at the ABC, a male boy who wanted to be a disc jockey. Well, the kid got his wish, and all the way up the line, you were there to give encouragement, to help him along the way. And that was me, of course, and, well, I've never forgotten. Ron, you were a top A&R man back in those days, and today I consider you to be the undisputed founding father of the modern recording industry as we know it. I salute you, Ron. I'm very proud to call you my friend. Congratulations. And you're 60? You're kidding!
You're 60! You're kidding!
I found that fascinating. There was Pete Smith up there, the bookend at Richmond. It's tremendous. Bruce Mansfield, we saw. You may worry about Bruce Mansfield. You notice he was sweating a bit there. You notice Bruce Mansfield was sweating? He was sweating like a pig. The fact was, they did that one day, just after Bruce had heard, Bruce wouldn't shout in the shark attack, Mansfield. We call him Sharky at 3AW. Bruce had just heard the bad news that a Paola truck couldn't find a parking meter outside Latrobe Street, and he was very upset. We did that. You resemble that remark? I understand that. He also turned up one night and found that Tina Arena had left the show.
And ladies and gentlemen, I love you all.
My God. That's the way they do the breakfast show, you see. Anyway, the next panel of friends, in quotes, of Ron Tudor's, we have Ernie Sigley, the heel of fortune. We also have, of course, John McDonald, who's known. I'm a comedian, I'm a journalist. He's known this reprobate for longer than anybody has. He's on the panel. And also, of course, we have the man who made my life hell for 7 months till they mercifully fired me at 3XY, Dick Hemming. He went to Perth because he found the pub shut later over there. Dick Hemming. Gentlemen.
Thanks, Darren. It's a privilege to be asked tonight to Jeff Hale's roast. I can't tell him apart, fading him. The garden gnomes. Ron, my claim to fame with Ron is I was his first record when I was 17, yeah. Which is 28 years ago. Ron came round to 3D me and said, I got this great record, Ernie. I don't know why he wanted to record me. And he said, Frankie Lane recorded in America, Love is a Golden Ring. He said, I think if you record, it'll be a hit. So this is in the days when Woggle and Goggle, W&G, were at a Beckett Street, which is all the Deros used to sleep outside and inside. Hello, Ralph. And so we made Love is a Golden Ring, and this is very true. They had no echo chambers in those days. So Ron said, I've got an idea. And Ron Tudor was the first guy in Australia to do this, and this ended up the trend in records for about 3 years. He said, we'll put the Neumann in the dunny. I said, what? He said, we'll put the Neumann in the dunny and we'll get the echo. And this is a true story. Tommy Davison was the band leader. Tommy kept saying to me, Jesus, Ernie, you sing out of tune. I said, well, Christ, so what? You know, it's just going to be a hit record. Like today, if you sing in tune, you don't get on record. But Tommy was so upset because I sang out of tune. Well, I did this Love is a Golden Ring. This is God's truth. The first take we did, Ronald, he was half whacked. Bill Armstrong was doing the audio. Tommy's conducting me, and it was really... Actually, it wasn't a bad song, was it, Ron? Ron went and had a bog halfway through the record. And it's still on tape to this day. It really is. So we made about... What did we make? About 20 records together, didn't we? All those bloody seven-day Adventists, Woggle and Goggle, weren't they? You couldn't do anything after 5 o'clock on a Friday because the sun, you know, they believed in the sun going down and... you know, and Ayers Rock and all that. Yeah, you couldn't do all that. But Georgie Bracken, the Australian lightweight champion, also was a Commonwealth champion, was recorded by Ron Tudor. So Ron had this brainwave that he'd get Georgie Bracken, who was defending his title against Maxi Carlos, to walk into the ring at the Melbourne Stadium and sing 3 minutes of Bloody Tiger in the middle of the ring before he fights. He got him to cover the Fabian version, which was a hit for Georgie Bracken, wasn't it? He was sort of a athletic Kamal, wasn't he, Bracken? Yeah. But... So that's just a little bit of the story. He recorded Gaynor Bunning, Olivia Newton, John, Heather Hort, everyone. But Ron, it's a bit brief. This, I am sorry I haven't got a bow tie, but I've just flown in from working in Adelaide, so I couldn't wear a juicy fruit on the plane. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for putting me on record. You know, my first record was done in a toilet. People say everyone's been shit out since. But thanks, Rod. God bless you, Ernie. Roger.
Thank you, Ernie Sigley.
Now some real truths.
Oh. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I've known Animal here for 25 years. Well, I knew him before he was Mongrel. And during that time, we've shared a lot of weird experiences, particularly as tourists tap dancing around the world. Which brings me to one story when we took Ron to Disneyland for the first time. And he had a couple of noggins, and he was real happy. I'm cleaning this up as I go. And he was taking in all the sights and just loved it. And sure enough, in a matter of time, along Main Street comes Mickey Mouse with a tribe of kids skipping along behind him. Savage and I are there. Tudor immediately leaves us, rushes over to Mickey, pushes the kids out of the way, shoved his hand out and says, "Mickey, Ron Tudor, Fayetteville Records, Australia."
You must have more than that.
I have. I was going to take this over to Reader's Digest and get it condensed, Ron, but they said they were working on your age. I remember another time we were sitting around Los Angeles with a bunch of real heavy musos. These guys were real bad characters, and they were into everything. They'd sniffed and snorted and shot and done everything they could with their bodies. And I was talking to them about a session, and Tudor was on the telephone or something, sitting beside the table talking to somebody. And one of these guys said to another guy, "Hey, man, you want some coke?" And Tudor said, turned around and said, "Yeah, I'll have one of them too." But one of my favorite stories is 1973. You'll have to explain it to the people here. When you don't use it, you don't know anybody who does, right? 1973, we were going to the International Music Festival in Cannes, in the south of France, and long time ago, and we were flying out of Sydney on Singapore Airlines. We got to Jakarta, and we were there for an hour, and Ron grabbed a couple of beers, and he's walking around the airport lobby, looking in shops, and he sees this blue batik shirt hanging on a coat hanger, and he said, "Jesus, I've got to get that," and he not only wanted to buy it right there and then, but he wanted to wear it. So he took off the shirt he had and stuffed it in a briefcase and put this blue batik shirt on. We get back on the plane, and when we get to Singapore, they tell us that the plane's developed engine trouble and we're stranded. And they don't know if they can get us on a plane to Rome. So we're there for 2 days in the clothes we're standing up in. We finally get a flight to Rome, and when we got to Rome, we'd missed the flight to Cannes. So we finally got a flight to Cannes. Then we got a bus to Nice, and we got a bus to Cannes, which was about 3 days from the time we'd been...
Didn't have been this long, you know. I should just keep telling the story.
Believe me, it's worth it. It's worth it. Just bear with me.
Just wake me up when you're finished.
That's all right. So we get there. Ron's wearing this shirt.
Sorry, Dix. Hey,
we're going to get it. Ron's wearing this shirt all the way anyway. Meanwhile, at this hotel, the old people who run it have been told that these people are coming from Australia, so the spritz to join up, and they've learnt all the basic words that they can say to us, like, "Hello, welcome to Cannes, Mr. Kangaroo," and a few others. Tudor and I get there. We're really rank by this time. We need a bath, so we check in. They got an English-French dictionary, and they're telling us how lovely it is in Cannes. We go up the room. Tudor says, "I've got to get a bath." Takes the shirt off, and the blue dye from the shirt has totally impregnated his body. So he says, "Jesus, how am I going to get this off?" So he gets in his bath. I go back to my room. About an hour later, Tudor's at the door. He said, "You better come and have a look at the bath, man." So I go into his room, and the bath is blue. The entire inside of the bath is blue. Tudor said, "What are we going to do?" He said, "We better go downstairs and tell these people." He said, "You're kidding. We can't tell these spooks, man." So we get in this little elevator, about as big as a telephone booth, and we go down to the lobby, and here's the old couple. They're still there. They've got the book. "Hello, you welcome to Cannes." Tudor walks up to the guy, and he says, "Listen, I got a problem in the room." And the guy says, "Le problème in the room?" Tudor said, "Yeah, the bath is blue, And the guy looks at Tudor and he says, "No, the bath is white." Woman, meanwhile, is saying to the guy, "What's the problem?" The guy turns around and says, "Monsieur Chamber, le bain est bleu." And the woman says, "No, no, le bain est blanc." So they both say to Tudor, "The bath is white." Tudor says, "Listen, it was white. It's now blue." So with that, we go up in the elevator, open the door, and the old woman went into a state of shock. The guy starts looking around the room. He thinks Tudor's painted the bath. All the time we were there, they just looked at us very strangely, never spoke to us again.
I guess you had to be there. Dick Hemming.
Thank you, Darren. Being on the end of this line of eulogy, I've heard a lot of things said, and it has certainly been said and will continue to be said, no doubt, over dinner tonight, how much Ron has contributed to the record industry. But I really got to know Ron by his contribution to the vocabulary of record hype. Now, I think the first time I ever heard the word ball tearer was a rather emotive experience until I realized it was only about a hit record. Because when Ron descends upon you in a record library and he says, "This is a ball tearer, baby," and it's the first time, you sort of back into the wall a little bit. However, that was good. But when I realized he was pushing a record, I was relieved. But then again, you realize he's always pushing a record. There was another occasion, I think I was at 3UZ at the time, and Ron comes into the tiny record library, and he said to Fred Tolley, he said, "Hey man, I got this great record, I want you to jump on it." And Fred said, "Put it on the floor, I'll do it." Another time he came in and he said, "This record has got hit written all over it." I couldn't see it. It must have been invisible ink or something. But that's the way the guy is. But I think I've had some sort of connection with Ron's progress in the area of record promotion and involvement in the record industry. I was involved as the catalyst between Neville Smith and Ron Tudor going there as national sales manager. I finished up with the job myself. I don't know how that works. And we went to the Flagstaff Hotel. And I think I even paid. I don't know where I got it back from Neville.
Two firsts.
But that's the way it happened. Ron, of course, at that stage was W&G, which wasn't making a lot of money. Ron wasn't making a lot of money, but he did have a lovely empathy with animal lovers. In fact, Ron used to spend his Saturday afternoon taking down on little pieces of paper interesting calls from animal lovers, mostly of the equine variety, but they would ring up and they'd say, "Ron," I don't know what they said, but he would note this very dutifully, and he had a lot of friends who had a lot of telephones in this place, and it was marvellous. I thought it showed a human touch to the Ron Tudor sort of development. In those days, too, there were only two really outstanding promotion men. For all those who can remember Harry Sutcliffe.
Oh, jeez. I got a letter from him the other day.
That sorted him out early, hasn't it? Yes. It was Harry Sutcliffe and Ron Tudor.
He made Milan Burke look like an amateur.
Right. And I was doing a show at UZ at the time called Jukebox Jury, and Harry would be... You can remember? There's somebody up there? Great. And Harry would come along flogging Marty Robbins and Ray Conniff. Ron would come along with such memorable hits as Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star by the Elegants, and She Wears Short Shorts by the Royal Tees. They were all great hits, and there was some incredible group called the Seekers. I don't know what happened to them, but doing this trade, I think that was the bit at the time. So I suppose I became involved in Ron's career to that point. There have been many milestones. I certainly remember the great party that launched Fable Records.
Is this available on J&B, this speech? Or...
is it?
I don't know.
Is that special? Is it with cornflakes?
Hurry up, Dick.
Oh, right. Okay, Ernie. Was it Boom Shalalala or Curly? Which was number one? Yeah. Curly was number one. All right, Curly. Well, anyway, that's all in the past. Your history has been well documented, and we love you for it. You're still in there hyping. I still get telexes saying, hey, Elvis, what about jumping on this? So everything's jumping. I hope you continue jumping, and thanks, Ron, for a great introduction to the bloody record industry right throughout Australia.
One thing surprised me there, I didn't realise that Dick was so eloquent and could make such a long speech. Of course, when you work with 3XY, he's never in the office long enough to do such a thing. I find tonight's even much better now. I've been here exactly 2 hours and 15 minutes, and I finally found a drink. Thank you. Whoever brought me a drink, tremendous. I can enjoy it too. Mr. Tudor, some of your, I won't say friends, I'll say some of your acquaintances, some of the people you probably bumped into or ripped off over the years, nudged a little bit, you know, pushed in the direction of television never to be seen again. Some of them actually branched out, despite you, and went overseas in search of the wondrous royalty check you told them you'd sent them. And some of them have thankfully, for their sakes, stayed overseas. They're with us tonight.
Ronnie Tudor. Happy birthday, mate. I believe you're 60 years old. But you shouldn't worry about it. I mean, 60's not that old. Well, you're a bit over the hill, I guess. But as long as you remember that you can't do all the things that you used to do, you should be all right. You know, those little fun things when you come running into the recording sessions. And when I was just a young, enthusiastic guitar player and you pick me up and give me a great big bear hug and you'd say, Farrow, love you, baby, you're a giant. I used to love that. But I believe you're still picking up enthusiastic young things and giving them bear hugs, right? Buttercup, sorry. I believe that's what they call you now. I always remember what great ears you had in those days. You seem to have a knack for pitting hits, as well as picking them. I remember one gorgeous song you brought me. It was called "The Love Moth." God, it was beautiful. I wept when I heard it, mate. And sure enough, it was a hit. That was in the real early days of the Fable label, when you were a pioneer then, mate. And I always remember another, talking of touching moments. When I said to you one day, Ron, do you think there's any chance that you might pay me for the 3 or 4 years work I've done for you? Writing, arranging and stuff. And you said, John, I'm really sorry, but the royalties have been donated to the Currumburra Children's Hospital. It was very touching. It was a beautiful thing you did, Ron. But in case everybody thinks you're a crook, which you're not, I had to clear that up. You did pay me half of it. And I know that the other half, may arrive even today. I know there's been a mail strike. But you always kept your word. So I'm not worried about that. But seriously, there are a lot of people involved in the recording industry in Australia, scattered about the world in various places, who do owe you a lot for the opportunity you gave them to learn about the recording industry at no cost to you and no cost to us. And we sincerely thank you. All jokes aside, you're quite an old fart. Happy birthday.
What I'd like to say is thank you for all your help in starting my career. I just think you're terrific, and I just want you to have a very, very happy birthday. And by the way, today is my birthday too. May 18th is my birthday, and I'm 30 years old. And we'd like to toast
You with some champagne. Happy birthday, Ron. Happy 60th.
Happy birthday, pal. Many more.
Have a wonderful, wonderful night, and you really are terrific. And John, when's the check coming?
Oh, you'll never see that, I tell you.
Say happy birthday, Ron.
Happy birthday,
cheers, you
Ron.
Have a great birthday. Give our regards to everybody down there.
When you first came here, you took me to the Hollywood Roosevelt Hotel, along with Owen, and I remember sitting at the bar. You took us for drinks. And the only other people that were at the bar were hookers. The whole bar was full of old broads, the ugliest hookers you ever saw. And you know what amazed us? They all knew your name. Anyway, I'm going to tell them you're 60. They're still sitting there waiting for you.
I'm the vice president of bullshit at Capitol Records. And, you know, I'm really, really flushed by this occasion. And that if you ever come up from down under, then you'd better drop in on me and enjoy your 60th, okay? By the way, this really does go clockwise.
Well, several people here have talked about royalties, and you all know that Ron Tudor is Ronald Tudor, MBE. As I said, mongrel bastard exemplified. And speaking of royalties, here's a bit of royalty.
It is a pleasure to have this opportunity to speak with you again after meeting you at the MBE presentation. I would just like to take this opportunity to wish you, Ron, a very happy 60th birthday and many more of them. When you are coming by the palace on your next visit, do pop in for some cucumber sandwiches and a pot of tea. Bye-bye.
Barbara told me to give you this back. Oh, and a daughter used it too.
Good evening, Rob. I am so sorry that I can't be with you physically tonight, particularly at the dinner later. I understand they're going to serve a great steak. I'd like to know who the lucky person will be who will eat it. But Rob, having said that, let me say this. For the past hour, people have been standing up here and defaming you. For very good reason. You know, I think I'd like to direct this next comment perhaps to the people around. Before Ron got into the record business, he did have a small shop up in Hamilton. That's where I live near there. It was a pest control shop. One day I called there to pick up some rat poison, and he said, do you want it wrapped or would you rather eat it here? I remember that well, Ron, and I'm sure you do too. In relation to other matters, look after yourself, Ron. I'm sorry I lost the election for you. By Jove, looking at there, you look like you've got gunpowder on your face. It looks pretty shot. Well, good day, and have a good dinner. Happy 60th.
Happy birthday, Ron. I really treasure my red toothbrush.
Hi, Ron, and all concerned, this is Bert Newton on the set of Four New Faces. I'd love to be with you, but as you know, I'm still barred from AAV after pushing Jeff Hales down the stairs. It was all a misunderstanding. I thought it was you, Ron. And it's very appropriate that I should be speaking to you from New Faces because, of course, Ron, you made such a great contribution to this program, which unfortunately had to be terminated when we discovered you in the prop bay one night after the show offering one of the acts your own personal encouragement award. As you know, Ron, I've got the greatest respect for you as both a man and also as a professional. I personally think that you have made the greatest contribution to the recording industry in Australia since Bob King Crawford released an Inside Start 45 of the Hawthorne Salvation Army band playing the Beatles. We do go back a long way, Ron, some 30 years. And I can remember how in the 50s a lot of the old 3XY boys thought because of your beard and your suede shoes, you were suspect. I personally never had any doubts, old friend. I knew you were. I know time is the essence of the contract, so Ron, I've gathered those that love you here at New Faces to wish you a happy birthday.
Happy birthday, shithead.
Seriously, Ron. Ron, we do wish you a happy birthday and thanks for the friendship and the good times. How old is Ron, by the way? Pardon? 60? Ron Tudor, 60? Ah, you are... He's left out a few fruit pickings. 60? Megan's older than that. Ron Tudor, 60? You've got to be kidding.
You're 60! You're kidding!
By the way, Ron, I am still looking forward to receiving a red toothbrush from you.
Today, Friday the 18th of May, 1984, sees the father of the Australian recording industry celebrating his 60th birthday. Ron Tudor, MBE, or Mongrel as he's known to his close associates, was approached today for comment on an international incident in which he's allegedly involved, known in political circles as the Red Toothbrush Affair. It involves Buckingham Palace. Mr. Tudor declined an interview and said, "You're kidding." More details as they come to hand.
Happy birthday for the montage at the end, Ron.
From little mongrel to big mongrel, happy birthday, mate.
Happy birthday, Ron.
Happy birthday, boss.
Happy birthday, mongrel.
Happy birthday.
Hope it's a great 60th birthday for you, mate, and all the very best from myself and my family.
Happy birthday, Tudor.
Great acid.
Happy birthday, Ron. I'm sure you'll know what I mean when I say have a sensational day.
Happy birthday, you old bearded mongrel.
Happy birthday, Ron, Mighty Ralph, and everybody from the restaurant. I'll see you later.
Happy birthday, Ron. All my love.
If you're 60, the oldest looking 60 I've ever seen. But happy birthday anyway, you mongrel.
Happy birthday, Ron, you mongrel.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, little ray of sunshine. Happy birthday to you. On your Ron.
Ron, I'd only appear on camera for you. Happy birthday.
Ron, I'd like to introduce you to my cousin. She's the blonde there in the corner looking shy. I know it's rather rude and I hate to intrude, but she's admired you since she was knee-high. To see you think she was a quiet lass, but you should see her take her clothes off the dance. You'd rate her as a 10 and she loves mature men. That is, she loves them every time she gets a chance. Her father is the owner of a brewery. She manages a pub close to here. She's got a penthouse suite round in Moray Street, and she likes a half bar full of beer.
Sensational.
She sounds like Barbara Streisand, and she writes like Carly Simon. That's no hype. And no matter what we do, she says she just wants you. But let's forget it, there's no way that she's your type. After work, we're gonna deal with Coxie, and he's gonna close the Roxy for the night so we can really go berserk. We've got a half bar for you for the evening, and 100 lovely girls in see-through lace. They look nice and clean, but who knows where they've been, so we got a bar the champagne just in case. Linda Ronstadt's flying in to do the floor show. She's happy to be meeting you at last. She's very keen for Fable to be her record label, and she likes the thought of giving you a blast. There'll be fish with aphrodisiac for supper, served by topless schoolgirls daubed with cream. And in the rooms up above, everyone will fall in love. But I guess you'd rather just go home and dream. A little bit rude. suppose you'd like a trip to England.
I imagine that you'd be completely bored.
It's the modest affair, 2,000 there. You kneel down and someone taps you with a sword. And we've had a special message from the palace that the Queen would like to give you tea or two. And the Duke will be away, so perhaps you'd like to stay. The Queen's got a red toothbrush there, mate. On the way, you could drop in and catch the Grammys. I believe they've put you in the Hall of Fame. And the single that you've done with Karen Knowles is number one. And the follow-up is bound to be the same. Andrew Peacock has been calling every hour. Says he wants you in the cabinet today. And we heard from David Frost, but we told him to get lost.
You what?
You'd never want to change your life in any way.
I don't have to tell most of you that that was put together by Peter Best. As a person who does telecom bond commercials, there couldn't be one more Ron Tudor because telecom couldn't possibly handle a fucking telegram. I would like to introduce Ron Tudor briefly now to a man who's with us tonight who will not be... will not be at dinner later on this evening, and hold on, I've got this properly. I've got to either do a Digby Wolf skip out of town, or I have to get bags under my eyes and have them later removed, a la Roger Clemson. This is your life segment. In the audience tonight is Captain Horry Berry, your army man from way back. Where is he? Captain Horry. What Captain Horry is now saying is that Ron got thrown out of the army for being homosexual and he only lasted 4 weeks in the training segment. You are indeed. Take up. But you wouldn't get up the microphone this easily. Yeah, take it over.
Well, what a parade. My first introduction to not this gentleman, but was 22. There were 22 Victorians in Oro Bay. It was approximately about 11 o'clock at night, and they landed on the beach. And I had a colonel, or a major then, because if you remember, who said, Berry, he said, you've got a problem. He said, you have 22 Victorians who have a record. And amongst those Victorians was one Ron Tudor. To stand up there at that stage, Ron, I'm only 4 years older than you, but if we go back in years, I can remember one voice saying, for goodness sake, look at this. Who's him? Who's him? And he's telling me, just saying, Good God. That is an officer. That was me. Any rate, I think my most interesting times was getting Ron out of jail. It's a story we won't go into. There are many stories. On that screen tonight were three soldiers, and I think you know them well, don't you? Every year, come, I suppose it is 40 years now, Ron, we have met once a year, just for that short period, and I can assure you, he was a very fine boy. But Ron, I'm going to say this, I am not part of the entertainment era, but looking round, I see many wonderful faces. On my left here, one I disagree with all the time. Two, who has rubbed our noses in the dirt of the MCG, Collingwood, because I'm a Melbourne supporter. I could go on. Ernie Signley, who's my wife's pin-up. I could go on, but all I'd like to say is this. Thank you very much, Chris Berry, my nephew or my brother's son, for inviting me to meet these wonderful people. I wish I had the years that you are going to have, and Ron, that you have given these people. You gave me, you helped me in many serious incidences with a lot of other boys. And I just want to thank you very much that I'm, and say to you that it's nice to have you as my friend. No lie.
I'll be short, believe it or not, and I'll be honest. People think that roasts are something that you get there, and it's usually all male. I'm glad it's not tonight, or I wouldn't have come. You get to a roast, and you get up there, and you insult and attack a person as hard as you can, and let out a few home truths the way that some have been let out tonight about Ron Tudor. I would say that what Horry Berry said tonight is the best thing that anybody could ever say at anybody's 60th birthday. And Horry, I'm glad you're here. I love what you said, and it's fantastic. Because, you know, we come to things like this and we bitch and we moan sometimes, and I know Ron spun the barrel and dragged a lady along to my 40th birthday. Because he knew his name mentioned the paper 3 days later on St. Valentine's Day. But we come along and we bitch and we moan. We are a very vicious industry, and we're a bunch of bastards at times. We really, the tall poppy thing doesn't even exist. They don't even grow in this bloody industry. They don't even get to be buds, let alone being chopped down. And this man knows it better than most people, the way we behave and the things that we do. I'll be honest, I am probably the least qualified person to get up here and talk about Ron Tudor. Because in the panorama, in the panoply of what's been said about him tonight, and the stuff we've seen on that screen there tonight, I am I'm a piece of sand, I'm a grain. Yes. Because, I agree with you. I would say, try a grain of sand in your shoe, I'm fucking irritable at times, and you know I'm there. But I have been here a short time. I don't know this man for very long. I haven't been in this town very long. And I'm a newcomer and a very young growth in this town. But I'll tell you one thing. In one area, and I'll say it very quickly and very sincerely, to Ron Tudor, he may dispute this now, but at the time I arrived in this town in radio, and people attacked me and said what I was, what I wasn't, and they questioned my parentage and things like that, there's a man here who at least, better believe to me, but he believed in what I was trying to do. and I copped the telegrams, and some of the telegrams of support at a time, like the electronic blackout, I got telegrams from man who said, I don't like you all the time, but you're trying to do something. And that's what Ron Tudor has done all his bloody life. You may not like what he does all the time, but you know he's trying to do something for himself, for his industry, and he believes. And for Christ's sake, if you believe in something, at least you're doing something. And that's what this man has done. And at 60, he's done something like, somebody told me once, if you don't, you don't get egg on your face unless you sit at the table. And that's what Ron Tudor has done. And I applaud you for it, mate. I applaud you for it. And he's a pain in the ass, and he phones me at 7 o'clock in the morning.
I'm going to try to... Sunday trading!
Excuse me, Darren. Jackie's on the phone. She just had the car.
Frank Penhalio could not be here tonight because he's very busy in Pentridge. This man, I'll say one more sentence and I'll make
it. Hitler.
Shut up. Sit down, Mansfield. There's no contra. The Bailey's Irish crew will be served at the Clarendon, not here. Sit down. And your car's finally finished being detailed. You want to pick it up on the way out. Obviously, Bruce Mansfield has two cocks. You couldn't be that stupid playing with one. That's not original. I steal those lines. I'll just say one more thing about Ron Tudor. That in my case, and I think it applies to a lot of people who have been here and been on that screen from overseas, in a funny way, I didn't even know him. He believed in me and believed what I was trying to do here at a time when Bert Newton, who sometimes gives me a few minutes later, television program, he believed in me at a time when he was trying to do, when Newton was king of the radio in this town, and he kept telling me, keep at it, believe what you're doing, and stay with it. You may not win it, but I believe you will. And mate, I salute you. I'll be honest, I wouldn't be here otherwise on a Friday night, unless I believe it totally sincerely. You're a great guy, and also, your daughter introduced me to my wife. Ron Tudor, it's your honor.
Just try and get a little control in here.
Am I supposed to say something?
Yeah, right. Okay, you mongrels, please sit down. Yeah. I would like to try and get a little control in here and firstly say thank you, Darren. And especially to my CO in the Army, Horry Berry. Thank you, Horry. It was great stuff. I don't know who's responsible for this, but I have a few suspicions, and one person I would like to share some of the blame, or whatever it is that you kind of share on these occasions, I would like to invite up here with me now. My daughter, Megan. I know you're out there somewhere. And I think it's especially appropriate since Darren was the host this evening, because Darren was introduced to his wife by my daughter, Megan.
But I was not asked to the wedding, Darren.
Could I just say to... I really am quite overwhelmed by what has taken place tonight, because I was just going out to have a quiet dinner with some people, and we aren't going to have a quiet dinner, are we? We're going to have a pretty wild dinner, and when I look around the room and I see people like Ralph Rickman and John Proper and Dick Hamming and Vanessa Venning's here too.
Fiona Holt
and Sam and Glenn Wheatley and John Horwood and Randall McDonald, all those people, thank you. I don't really know what to say. I mean, I've just been one of those people who was lucky to get into an industry when there was no industry really. And I was fortunate enough to be given the opportunity to do something, and with the help of a lot of people around me, like Fred Tolley and Bruce Mansfield and all you other. It has been nice, and the things that were said here tonight are...
That's got to be Peter Sullivan.
All the things that were said in person tonight and the things that were said on the screen, especially by John Farrar, I thought was very exciting anyway. But I don't really know what to say, Megan, from here on. Wally Bishop, I see him there, and...
Glenn, I'm sure... And, Glenn, I think you have a few words to say. It's not always going to be like this, right? Yeah. I think that many, many thanks and sincere thanks must go to the people at AAV whose brainchild this was. Thank you.
Yes.
David. This is great.
And... I would really like to know who is totally responsible for this night.
David Wilson.
David Wilson.
David.
Did you actually do all this on your own? Hey.
David, please come up for a moment.
Come over here. Ted Gregory and John Horwood, Andrew, it couldn't happen without you. David.
Yeah, we should have Cat out here.
Yeah,
where's Cat? Where's Cat? Cat and McVitty? That's for you, Higgins. On the floor? We don't. This is all a facade. Huh?
And you can always bore each other to death with Mr. Tudor. I am a bit worried about him. First of all, I worry that I am have been compromised, and you know my integrity should never be compromised. I'm worried that I'm compromised with the fact that I'm here tonight after playing all those shit records he sends me all the time, the first releases. The only man in Australia who played Peter Sullivan's Irish Eyes Are Smiling.
Hey, yeah!
Even though Sullivan got the words wrong, as I was pointing out to me on Talkback Radio, the other thing is, of course, that I'm glad in one way that the woman who's behind all of this, who has been a friend of mine, well, an acquaintance at times, a friend of mine, Megan Tudor, who, well... I'm glad she's out of the PR business in a certain way, because my secretary is no longer embarrassed when she sends me invitations to functions, these glossy, wonderful, gold embossed invitations that all say to Darren Hinch and fuck. Thank you, Megan. I'm glad you're out of the business. And to all of you, thanks for coming. Dinner is on, and Ron Tudor, happy 60th birthday, mate.
Hey, thank you.
Happy birthday to you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm involved in Young Talent Time, looking after the kiddies. All right, you may laugh, but I look after the young girls and boys at Young Talent Time. We have been together tonight to recognize Ron Tudor. And I think...
Turn the camera off!
And we're recognizing a very good friend in the industry, because I've known Ron for many years, and most of you have done the same. And I think Ron Tudor
should be recognised not only for a... Darren, if you're getting the wind-up...
No.
Honestly, I'm very sincere on this.
Bullshit!
You're failing, Bruce.
God, Bruce!
Now listen, quite honestly, and ladies and gentlemen, I love you all. I go out every Saturday night with the and ladies and gentlemen, I love you all. Listen, I go out every Saturday night with Young Talent Time.
You're not wrong.
And they are young girls and young boys who are wanting to get into the industry. And they come up to me and they say, how can I do it? And I'm with them. These are young kids. Let's be quite honest. Young girls like Tina Arena. They come up. These young children. These young children come up to me and they say, how can I get into the industry? And I say, well, look, come into my dressing room. We will talk about it. We will chat about it. And that's it. Honestly, thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Good night.